We're going to be reading the Bible together now. Mark chapter 13, if you've got one of the Black Church Bibles, it's page 1017. So Mark chapter 13, and we're going to read the whole chapter together. As Jesus was leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what massive stones, what magnificent buildings." "Do you see all these great buildings?" replied Jesus. "Not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things happen, and what will be the sign that they're all about to be fulfilled?" But Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming, 'I am he,' and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, don't be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginning of birth pains. You must be on your guard. You'll be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you'll stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them, and the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, don't worry beforehand about what to say. Just say whatever's given to you at the time, for it's not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. Everyone will hate you because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. When you see the abomination that causes desolation standing where it does not belong, let the reader understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let no one on the housetop go down or enter a house, the house to take anything out. Let no one in the field go back to get their cloak. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. Pray that this won't take place in winter, because those will be days of distress unequaled from the beginning, when God created the world, until now, and never to be equaled again. If the Lord hadn't cut short those days, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect whom he has chosen, he has shortened them. At that time, if anyone says to you, 'Look, here is the Messiah,' or 'Look, there he is,' don't believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. So be on your guard. I've told you everything ahead of time. But in those days following that distress, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And he'll send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens. Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that it is near, right at the door. Truly, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Be alert. You don't know when that time will come. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house and puts his servants in charge, each with their assigned tasks, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you don't know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, don't let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone. Watch."
Good morning, my name is Mitch, and it's my terror to preach that passage this morning. Let's ask God for his help. Our Father, there are lots of parts of your word that are really clear, and this is not one of them. And so we ask this morning for your help. You give us wisdom to hear you speak to us through these words. Father, you'd allow us to be challenged about what we find our security and our foundation in. And Father, you'd give us hope to persevere, to see the glory of Jesus. Amen. Well, I don't know if you know, but there was every chance the world was going to end on Friday, and I was really hoping that was the case. There was a series of massive eclipses across the Northern Hemisphere, which apparently is a sign. There's also been some other things like a super moon. There's been an equinox to contend with. Then there's the blood moon prophecy. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Some of you may have read the blogs. It refers to a theory, let me try and get this right, that a tetrad of four consecutive lunar eclipses with six full moons between them is about to occur, which is clearly a sign that the world is coming to an end. Then there's also the book called Four Blood Moons. Very big at the moment. This one says a major world-changing event is happening on September the 28th this year. Although that's in the Northern Hemisphere in America, so if you want to be accurate, it's probably about 10 a.m. on September the 27th here. And its claim is that because of the way these moons line up this year and what the Bible says, clearly something profound is going to happen. Although the guy who wrote the book doesn't tell you exactly what it is, I suspect you're going to need to buy the second book to find that out. I bring all of this up because you read a passage like this, and one of the big questions you're asking is, what is this about? Is this about the end of the world? It's got wars and rumours of wars and something that's called the abomination that causes desolation. And you read it, and part of you thinks, what is all that? In fact, leading Bible commentators, the guys who are the experts about this, have written such things as this. In the Gospel of Mark, there is no passage more problematic than this discourse of Jesus on the destruction of the temple. And another one says this: the absence of the original context of the various sayings and their indefiniteness combined to make this one of the most perplexing chapters in the Bible to understand for readers and interpreters. These are the guys who do this for a living. And somehow, in the midst of all that, the NBC staff team has decided, I know what we'll do with this passage, we'll give it to the young guy. And the only qualifier was that I didn't say anything crazy about the end of the world, but I already have. Mainly though, the whole thing is not about the end of the world. It's mainly about the Jewish temple. It's mainly about what was the firm and secure cornerstone of the disciples' religion and life, the place where they found their security and their foundation. The opening verses of the chapter give us the kind of framework that guides us. In verse 1 of chapter 13, what you see is the disciples and Jesus, they're standing on a hill just outside Jerusalem and they're looking down at the temple. And in verse 2, Jesus says, "See these great buildings? Not one stone here will be left on another that will not be thrown down." And the guiding question for the chapter is from the disciples in verse 4. When will these things happen? When will these buildings be thrown down? And what will be the sign? And throughout the passage, that's mainly the question Jesus is answering. And it's so important to these disciples because of everything the temple meant to them and their religion and what they thought about God and their way of life. And so much more important because in verse 30, Jesus says, all these things will happen in your lifetime. It's big business for them. But I do think in the midst of all this, there is a small but hopeful glimpse from Jesus about the end of the world, or more precisely, the second coming of Jesus. And I want to be up front and say there's been quite a difficulty here, because there are plenty of faithful and thoughtful biblical Christians who say this whole chapter is just about the temple. And there are plenty who say it's mainly about the temple with a little bit about the second coming of Jesus. And so I think you can think either of those things and be okay. And in fact, one of the great tensions this week is that within our own MPC staff team, we think something different. And so if Jeremy was up here preaching this morning, the talk would have been slightly different. But we're okay with that because what's important is that all of us faithfully and thoughtfully read the text the best we can. And the main thrust is unquestionable. It's how these disciples will cope when something they hold to be so foundational and a secure bedrock of their life is gone. How will they cope when their worst fears are realized? Now look, the temple for us is very hard to understand. This is actually a scale model of it. It looks like it's pretty good and realistic, doesn't it? But it's actually about the size of four matchboxes in the scale. But I think, you know, being so distant from it, we tend to think, if we ever think about the temple, that, you know, Jerusalem's kind of a city and there's the temple like Queen Street Mall in the middle. Nothing like that. It's not a city with a small temple. Jerusalem is a temple with a small city attached. Right? The temple is everything. Now, massive stones, some of 15 metres long, weighing 100 tonnes. And the temple used to be just the religious centre of their life, just the place where God was. But then a guy called Herod came to power just a little while before, and he wanted to transform it. He extended it, he extended its precinct, and soon it became the kind of shopping centre and the political centre. It was now the urban centre, the cultural centre, the economic centre, the political centre, the religious centre of the entire Jewish world and of Israel. And Jesus is saying, it's all going to go. It's going to be smashed. How do you respond when something so firm and secure comes crashing down? It would have generated massive insecurity for Jesus' disciples, massive fear. You know, we've called this series An Insecure Christian's Guide to Jesus, how Jesus answers our fears and doubts. And I think when you come to a passage like that, this, we need to realize that there are things that we find firm and secure that if they were gone, it would generate massive insecurity for us. You know, you walk into a meeting on Monday, everything's normal, and you walk out without a job. One week, you're planning a nice family holiday. The next week, your husband or wife announces, I'm sorry, I've had enough. You go to the doctor for a little pain that was there, and 3 days later, the results come, and your world is turned upside down. When you're struck with the foundations and the bedrock of your life being overthrown, what do you do? What do you do? I don't know if you've ever seen the show Doomsday Preppers, but basically Doomsday Preppers is about people who are getting themselves ready for the end of the world. It's become a massive phenomenon in America since the global financial crisis. And people have started getting ready for the end of the world in all kinds of ways, like Donna Nash. She is worried about a flu pandemic that suddenly, she says, it could happen within hours. A couple of people with a cold get on a plane and the whole of America is swept by flu panic. And so Donna has bought herself literally a pallet of face masks. She has half a container of body suits and enough plastic wrap, no exaggeration, to wrap her house in. And by Donna's own admission, she is anxious and fearful 20 hours a day. So worried about it. As we turn back to the passage, we see Jesus warning his disciples there will be an increasing anxiety and panic and fear as the destruction of the temple approaches. They've asked Jesus what the signs will be that the temple's about to go, and Jesus tells them. In verse 8, nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There'll be earthquakes in various places, famines. This is not the time, it's the beginning. And their own personal security will come under threat. Because as the central religious system of Judaism comes down, their life and their relationship with God will seem like it's coming down too. There will be immense suffering. In verse 9, they'll be handed over and flogged, standing before governors and kings for their faith in Jesus. In verse 12, families will implode and turn against each other. And then a moment, in verse 14, when they can be sure the temple's about to go. A moment that seems to us a little bizarre, but to them, apparently easy to understand. In verse 14, when you see the abomination that causes desolation standing where it should not be, that's the moment, run. The abomination that causes desolation is a phrase from the Old Testament book of Daniel. It's a phrase in their culture that reminded them of a time in the past when a pagan king had come into their Jewish temple and put a statue of Zeus there. And they called that the abomination that caused desolation. And Jesus is using that same phrase now to say something is coming that will be obvious, it's all about to come down. As to exactly what Jesus is pointing to, it's hard to tell. Some people say the sign is that Jesus is being killed on the cross because there couldn't possibly be more of an abomination than the Son of God dying. Others say that the sign is that the armies will surround the temple of Jerusalem, and when all the pagan armies are surrounding the whole thing, that's it. It's the end. I think it's probably that. Whatever it is, they knew what it was, and they knew that's when the bedrock of their life would be trashed, ripped out from under them. A time of great distress in verse 19, when all of it would go, all within their life. And in fact, it did go. I mean, you can go and see the ruins of the temple still today. I mean, 70 AD, after what was 18 months of civil war in Rome, they spun through four emperors. It wasn't a pleasant time for anyone. And eventually, at the end of that, in 70 AD, a Roman general named Titus, in order to prove his power and goodness to the latest emperor, marches into the temple precinct and smashes the lot. And it's gone. How confronting. We can only imagine the tragedy and horror first up, let alone what it did to their national and personal identity. You know, I think there are times when we get a glimpse of stuff like this, when the foundations of life are ripped away and it's incredibly scary. Just a couple of weeks ago, my friend, who's my age, he lost his father. His dad died of cancer. The one he went to for advice, for a beer, for Christian wisdom, for a rest, he's gone. And so my friend joins many who now find themselves part of the fatherless generation, their previous foundation gone. And you know, losing your job, it's all very academic and exciting when you're young and you can go and find a new one. But then as you grow older, losing your job is just frightful. Who'll feed the family? Who'll pay the bills? I think I've got 3 months of savings, but there's cancer, sickness, those inevitable questions of eternity that send your head into a spin. These are the kind of feelings the disciples are going through as they're confronted by the death of the temple, which in many ways feels like the death of their nation, the death of their God, and potentially of themselves. So Jesus wants to reassure them that despite all they go through, if they have their foundations and security in him, they will share in Jesus' glory. Tucked in the midst of this talk about the temple is something else that Jesus says in verse 24, following that, after that time of distress, there's something else. An earth-shattering moment when God would come to live with his people. A time in verse 76 when Jesus, the Son of Man, will come in the clouds with great power and glory. You read that in verse 26, Jesus will come in with great clouds and power and glory. And I think what we think of when we read that is, you know, those kind of postcards or those, you can get those big painted pictures, I think, at Koorong or on the internet. And there's a cloud and like a ray of sun is some kind of Caucasian Jesus walking down a set of steps coming towards you. You read that and that's what you're thinking of. It's hard not to go past that. We've seen it so much. I don't know why Jesus is always Caucasian. He lived in the Middle East. He most certainly was not. But anyway, it totally misses the point. There are two things going on in this verse which are important, okay? Two things. One is clouds and glory. And the other is that Jesus is coming in or with them, right? First one, clouds and glory. Follow me here. The whole thing about clouds is not about the weather. It's thick with Old Testament imagery. Throughout the Old Testament, when we see clouds, it's when God comes with them. At Mount Sinai in Exodus, God comes down on Mount Sinai with clouds. He's there. When God's glory enters the tabernacle in Exodus 40, the clouds come and God is there. When their temple is finished in 1 Kings 8, the cloud comes down with God and he is there. God's presence, his goodness, the Hebrew word is Shekinah. It meant a whole big thing for these people. It meant that God will be there and things would be restored. When God comes, there would be no more wars or rumors of wars, no more families turning against each other, no more uncertainty about the security of their life, no more threats to them. God would be there. That's the first bit, the clouds. The second bit is that Jesus comes in the clouds or with them. It's not that he comes through the clouds and then he's there and they're gone. It's that he brings them. This is an Old Testament quote from Daniel 7. In Daniel 7 is where we first see this Son of Man picture. In Daniel 7, the picture is this victorious Son of Man who has a victory in battle, and then the Son of Man goes to God, called the Ancient of Days, and he goes to God and he receives glory. That's the picture in Daniel chapter 7. Son of Man goes and receives glory. Jesus uses this quote in Mark 13, but changes it ever so slightly. Because now the Son of Man doesn't come to receive glory, the Son of Man comes with glory. He's been victorious. He has God's power. He's resurrected. He's been with his Father. And at the second coming, when he comes next time, he comes with power and glory. And he will say to his followers and to his disciples, all of those things you've been through, all of those things you've persevered through, all of those threats to your security, I'm here now, it's over. And that is the comfort he calls out to them. Read from verse 26 with me. At that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. He'll send his angels to gather his elect from the four winds. It just means from everywhere, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heaven. Here's what Jesus is saying in unquestionably grand language, but language that they would have understood. Disciples, I will have power and glory. Your temple is going to be smashed. You will feel like you have been. But make me your foundation and it will be okay. See, disciples want to know what they'll do when the current foundation of their life is ripped from them, and Jesus says it will be terrible. But he says to them, no matter what security you lose, if you have me, you'll be okay. I wonder what it is that is the foundation and security of your life. The bedrock, the thing that you stand on. Because if it's true that there is a moment when Jesus will return and the whole world will be turned upside down, if that's true, what will you stand on at that moment? What will be your foundation at that moment? It's a guy called Francis Schaeffer, and he does a nice little thought experiment about a thing called the invisible tape recorder. And this is not actually it. This is the tape recorder you can see. Francis Schaeffer's invisible tape recorder. He says that, okay, so pretend, just go with me. You've got a necklace on, and on it is a little invisible tape recorder. And it only records when you're giving advice to other people about how to live. Right? The only time it records is when you're telling someone else a few tips on how to live. And what if the only way that God assesses you when Jesus comes back is not by his standards, no, not at all, but all he does is get that tape and play it back. And all he does is hold you up against your own life advice. How would you go? You wouldn't have a leg to stand on. I wouldn't. The disciples wouldn't. The return of Jesus, the return of God coming back down towards us, it should be catastrophic. It should freak the disciples out more than the destruction of the temple. It should scare us. And maybe that's why we don't think about the second coming very often, because it's so confronting. But there's a reason the disciples can look to the second coming and be comforted, not confronted. It's because the foundation of their life ultimately is not the temple, but what Jesus has done. See, because Jesus in his first coming takes God's judgment, in his second coming, he can share God's glory. Just moments after this passage, really, Jesus will go to the cross and die for our own shortcomings and our sin and take God's judgment and anger on himself, so that when we trust in him and when we meet God, God will play our invisible tape recorder and watch our life, and all he'll hear is Jesus' words and see Jesus' life. And he'll say, "Come to me with glory." See, when the foundation of your life is the cross of Jesus, your response to the world coming to an end, your response to things in your life that you find so secure coming crashing down, is a determined watchfulness and trust in Jesus. Not a bizarre fanaticism that sees you looking endlessly for lunar eclipses. I mean, look, the idea that you would look at a passage like this and then fanatically start looking for signs of the end, I mean, it is ridiculous. Look at verse 32, right? Here's the kind of closing section. Verse 32, Jesus says, "Now about the time, no one knows the day or the hour, neither the angels nor the Son, just the Father." Here is Jesus, the Messiah, the one who will be coming back with glory, who says, "You know what, we're not quite sure when it happens." And yet against this, people have created a whole industry saying, "I know that Jesus doesn't know, but there's a fair chance I do." What is that? It's insane. The way to live like God is the way to live is like God is the master of the house, and any second he could come home. The way to live is like Jesus is victorious, and at any second he's coming with glory for those who trust in him. Or as it's repeated throughout this last section, be alert. Just read these few verses from verse 33 with me. "So be on guard, be alert. You don't know when the time will come. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house, he puts his servants in charge, each with their assigned tasks, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. So keep watch. You don't know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or dawn. If he comes suddenly, don't let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch." You know, the message here is to be alert and to watch in light of Jesus coming. And I do want to say there are people here, I think, whose life is marked not by watchfulness, but by sleepiness, a sort of flailing apathy and indifference to all this stuff. You weren't freaked out when we read the passage. You were just, meh. I'm talking about some Christians. You sort of turn up to church maybe every third week when the weather's not so good. You say grace, but that's it. You don't know your neighbour, and it doesn't bother you because somehow the work of Jesus on the cross isn't relevant to them and you're too busy. And generally, I'd say for this class of people, you feel like your life is firm and secure and your foundations are all right. Your job's okay, family's okay, your money's okay, but your Christianity is marked by an apathy and sleepiness. Wake up. The temple was smashed, and so was Jesus. And if you keep mucking around with the foundations of your life, you could be too. But that's not where I want to finish. I was thinking about this, and kind of, if you've been here for the last few weeks of our talk, you know what I felt like every week for the last 5 weeks? Like I've been kicked in the stomach. It's been a hard series. Because my observation is that there are actually a whole bunch of people here who live an alert and faithful life waiting for Jesus in a very real way. This church, I think, is actually a testimony to living ready for the returning Jesus. Here's why. Against the sort of cultural trends that the words of Jesus are out of date, this church, in all its congregations, has prized clear, Christ-centered, faithful and thoughtful Bible reading and teaching in all our lives and at every opportunity. And surprisingly, in doing that, over the last 5 years, the number of kids who come to our kids' ministry has doubled. And we're making them read the Bible. It shouldn't work. Our young adults ministry, when I came here as a member of the congregation about 8 or so years ago, there were about 80 people. Now on a Sunday night, there are 250 between village church and late church. In this congregation, since 2001, there are 40% more people here than there were. And that's after we've planted another church in Eatonshill, which has grown from about 40 to 150 under its own steam. Most of you are here against the prevailing consensus that God is irrelevant, that life is secure and not much will happen. But you have chosen to base your life on the firm and secure risen Lord Jesus. And that's before it even gets personal. Some of you have been following Jesus long enough to see your health taken away and given back or slowly degrade. Some of you have been here long enough to see your husband or wife walk out or die. Jobs have come and go. You've been betrayed by father or brother or sister or child. Some of you have literally been surrounded by armies, or your husband has. Some of you have been hauled before the courts. Some of you have been forced to start again with basically nothing. Some of you have had to relearn to share your faith several times because it's no longer politically correct to say the things you once said. But you're here. And I don't need to tell you that so many things we think in our life are firm and secure. You need to tell us. Because many of you have trusted Jesus in a simple and gritty and determined way. With neither apathy nor fanaticism, the cross has convinced you to wait it out to Jesus' glory. And that's what it means to be alert. I'll just have to pray. Seems bizarre to have got there, Father, out of a passage like this. I guess we want to confess to you, Father, up front that we're a bit apprehensive about some of the things in a passage like this, and we want to be humble about how we understand it. Father, we ask that you would help us to see just what it is we think makes us firm and secure, and if those things cause us to never think about you, please wake us up. And Father, we ask that you would continue to help us in the midst of our lives to wait it out for Jesus' glory. And Father, to base ourselves completely on the work that Jesus has done at the cross. We pray for the strength of your Spirit in doing this. And as we continue to live against the prevailing trends of our world, we ask you'd help us to never lose sight of what's ahead of us. Amen.